This town is a lonely town, not the only town like this town. This town is a make you town or a break you town and bring you downtown. This town is a quiet town for a riot town like this town.
Good evening. My name is Richie Pérez. I'm a member of the Committee Against Fort Apache, and I'm here tonight to talk about the movement that developed in the South Bronx against the film Fort Apache and the continuing efforts to counteract negative images of Puerto Ricans and blacks in the media. In 1980, Time Life Films came into the South Bronx with millions of dollars to make a movie about the South Bronx and about police in particular in the South Bronx. For the next year and a half, a community coalition made up of grassroots organizations, which included community agencies, the church, organizations of activists, challenged the images of the film Fort Apache, as well as challenging the right of filmmakers to exploit poverty conditions in the ghettos. We utilize a wide variety of tactics, and we'll be seeing some slides illustrating that. But let me say, first of all, that in entering into the struggle, we understood that film has a cumulative effect, and that over the years there had been a number of films that had portrayed Puerto Ricans and established the roles in which Hollywood was going to show our people. Films like Black Boy Jungle, films like The Young Savages, films like, for example, Boardwalk, The Exterminator, which came out prior to Fort Apache, all established Puerto Ricans as criminals, social parasites, with particular focus on Puerto Rican women as prostitutes. Well, actually, there was a tremendous dichotomy in the roles Puerto Rican women had, either virginal beauties to be protected and cherished, or promiscuous, hot-blooded Latin women wild at the sound of a conga drum. All of those stereotypes had been established in a series of films, and now Fort Apache was going to add to that treasure of stereotypes and update them and put them in the context of the urban situation. Fort Apache spoke to many issues that we were dealing with in our lives: police brutality, arson, for example, housing abandonment, and the decay of our communities. But it failed always to show what were the root causes of those problems, and instead blamed the problems on the people who lived in that community itself. Over a period of time, we adopted the position that we would stop Fort Apache in the streets during its filming, or we would stop it in the theaters, with the understanding that a movement does not yet exist that is strong enough to stop films cold throughout the nation. But we learned some tremendous lessons that we would like to share with everybody, because we think there were great accomplishments, and one of the things that we proved was that it is possible to have unified, collective, and effective action against racism. In addition, there was a continuation, there's a process of continuation, since as modern days come along, films begin to be recycled. They're made, and then they are recycled onto home box office, and then they are recycled once again. They're recycled once again onto television, and that's one of the situations that we're facing. So it's not enough to deal with films in the process of them being made or in the process of them being distributed. There's a question of how do we then deal with the new technology, which moves those same films and recycles the racist images and the sexist images onto cable television, and then finally onto the regular TV screen. One of the things we also learned was that we were fighting a tremendous monster, that the ability of Time Life Films to broadcast its racist and sexist images was much greater than our ability to broadcast our challenge. The media itself blacked out much of the work that we tried to do, and was consistently concerned with whether or not there would be violence, whether or not there'd be nice action drama shots of police beating people and dragging them away, or of us chasing the film crew down the street. They were not, the media was not concerned, and one thing we learned, that the structure of the news media does not fit into what we would like to tell people. We would like to have long explanations of the root causes of the problems in our community, long indictments of people who come in to exploit those conditions. But that was not the structure within which we were working. So we had to develop mechanisms for reaching out to people and also for utilizing the media with the understanding that whole concept is a two-edged sword. That while we say we use the media, as often as not, they are still able to manipulate us. But the more conscious we are of that manipulation, the more able we'll be to make the best use out of the media itself. We accomplished a number of things in our struggle, one of which we think is extremely important, and that was through the protests and through the building of a national boycott, we were able to set a context in which people had to judge the movie. It was no longer a situation of just going into the theater, turning off your mind, and sitting there in the dark and thinking about the movie. Now the question was, once you cross the picket lines, is this movie racist movie or not? And people began to go into the theaters with a more critical frame of mind, which was very important for us. And we understood that we were not going to get everyone to stay out of the theaters, that is a goal, that we still have to build a movement that is strong enough and build a consciousness in this country about media racism. But we wanted to be able to set a context within which the film had to be analyzed, and we think we were extremely successful in that. Not only were we successful in setting the context for the public to analyze the film, but we were also successful in setting a context for the critics to analyze the film, so that in writing their reviews, all of the critics, without exception, had to deal with the charges that we had raised over whether or not Fort Apache was a racist film and did indeed stereotype Puerto Ricans and blacks. So the next things we're going to see are some slides that were taken during demonstrations. The next thing we're going to see is some information, background information that will give you a sense of who we were arguing with, who were we struggling with in this situation. Contrary to popular myth, we were not just dealing with some individual filmmakers expressing their artistic freedom. We were dealing with the major media conglomerates who control the production of artistic work in this country.
Hollywood. Stars, fantasy, fortunes, studios. That's what we think of as Hollywood. Today, it's a multi-billion dollar industry. However, in 1970, one of the questions they were asking is, Hollywood going to continue to exist? Because between 1969 and 72, the studios, the seven major studios, lost $250 million. From a peak attendance of 4 billion in 1946, it dropped to 820 million tickets in 71. In 1960, only five movies made over 40 million. In 1979, four movies made over 40 million, and some movies made over $500 million themselves. It's a dramatic change from disaster to unlimited opportunity. The gross domestic box office in 1983, $2.8 billion, and seven major studios shared in that profit. They got 87% of the profits. Universal got 20%, Paramount 16%, 20th Century Fox 16%, Columbia 14%, Warner Brothers 14%, and United Artists 7%. An industry that's always been marked by competition, but also by a lot of cooperation. By 1980, the industry had gone from decline to unlimited opportunity. What caused the decline? Television, Supreme Court rulings that studios can't own theaters, other decisions limiting studio contracts with actors. But most of all, the industry showed that it had an opportunity and a way to overcome these attempts to keep it from becoming a conglomerate. What caused its rebirth? An idea pioneered first by two Los Angeles attorneys, Arthur Krim and Robert Benjamin, who took over control of United Artists in 1951. Their unique idea? To provide only financing and distribution for the films. No studio plant, no overhead, no contract players. $6 million was provided by Walter Heller. What happened at United Artists spread all over town. By 1978, the main role in income for studios was guaranteeing distribution for its own products and for those produced by independents. The principle at work, spreading the risk. This happened in three ways. Producers raised part of the money themselves and came to studios to get the distribution. Studios also diversified. Not only did studios expand, but they also began to be bought up by conglomerates. You had Transamerica, which purchased United Artists. Transamerica, car rentals, computers, financing loans, life insurance, you name it. In fact, in 1978, Krim and Benjamin, who had been at United Artists, didn't like that conglomerate either, and they left, walked out. They formed Orion Pictures. They got a $150 million line of credit from the banks, plus guaranteed distribution from Warner Communications. And who did they go to for their money? Home box office, Time Inc.'s cable subsidiary, which now this year will be producing, spending as much money on movies in 1983, $250 million, as any Hollywood studio. They have committed $1 billion from now and to the future for it to be spent on movies. So the scramble is on. All the movie theaters, Warner Communications, which owns Warner Brothers. You have Gulf and Western, another huge conglomerate, which controls financial services, consumer products, video games, you name it, all kinds of products and different consumers. These are multi-billion dollar corporations. But all of these studios and all these conglomerates have one thing in common, the banks. Underlying this expansion was access to dollars. During the 70s, the companies, all of the studios, had to go into long-term debt in order to finance their films. This has been important because the banks that you see, the names dropping in front of the camera, these are the banks that are, sit on the board of directors, that sit, that control and advise and extend millions of dollars in credit, that determine what the American public is going to be seeing. And home box office, with its control of the home video market, it has over 50% of the cable subscribers, has now set up a partnership with Columbia and with CBS to form TriStar Productions. It's going to be producing films. In addition, this TriStar Corporation has formed Silver Screen to raise $128 million from private investors who want to get money into the movies as well. But the bottom line is that movie industry now expects to make billions of dollars in income. More than ever before, the movie industry is concentrated in the hands of the big banks and big conglomerates. Their board of directors include people ranging from Henry Kissinger to Walter Mondale to Princess Grace of Monaco and to other mainly big businessmen and executives. Hollywood, no more studios in the traditional sense, but unlimited opportunity and billions of dollars, not for the viewer, but for the industry, with racism, sexism, and all the other things that serve its interest to be put on the screen.
The next thing we're going to be seeing is some slides that were photos taken during demonstrations and during the development of the campaign against Fort Apache, and I'll be explaining what each one represents. This first one is a leaflet that we put out, and it includes the actual text of an ad taken out by Time Life Films prior to the demonstrations beginning. These are some newspaper articles that began to run in the South Bronx describing what the movie was about. Paul Newman himself received $3 million for his role in Fort Apache. His presence in the movie was troublesome to many people since he had a liberal reputation, and for us signaled the rightward trend in America and the fact that many liberals were now moving to the right and embracing messages and solutions that had once been the property of the right wing. Newman, at the beginning, defended the film as a work of art that would bring attention and bring sympathy for the struggle to rebuild the South Bronx. But eventually, as he was confronted by the situation, he began to sour on the film itself. Even before the film was finished, Time Life, using its immense international distribution network, was already selling the rights to the film throughout the world. This is an ad that they took for sales in a film convention in Italy. One of our first demonstrations in the South Bronx highlighted our understanding that the only success to confronting films of this type would be a broad-based mass coalition involving all types of people from our community united around the single issue of stopping this film and fighting the stereotypes that it was projecting, not only in the United States, but to the entire world. The film targeted not only the entire Puerto Rican and Black communities, but Puerto Rican and Black women in particular, who were stereotyped throughout. And in response, much of the leadership for the movement against Fort Apache came from women of all ages from our community. As the movement grew and as confrontation at the filming sites continued, more and more attention was directed to the film by newspapers and other media from around the country. It was very difficult to build a movement against the movie in light of all the problems that our community was facing. But one of the things that we learned, and that was very interesting, this was our first press conference in Lincoln Hospital in the Bronx. And it was very difficult for us to break the press blackout. And one of the tactics that we utilized was taking a $1 million lawsuit, which we knew we could not win, but we knew would drag them into court and force them to answer to our charges. The movement's strength really was its base of support in the community. Aside from other sectors of the population that supported us, without the strength of the strength and unity of the Black and Puerto Rican communities, our movement wouldn't have had the successes it did. The filmmakers were consistently trying to drive a wedge between the different sectors of the community and say that only the radicals supported this movement. But it was to the commendation of everyone involved that no Black or Puerto Rican in our community who was not on the Time Life payroll came out and defended the movie. These are scenes from a demonstration in the area around Lincoln Hospital. Many of the politicians, once the movement had began, threw their support behind the movement. Here's some articles describing Congressman Robert Garcia's support at a press conference held right in front of the 42nd precinct, which the police themselves had named Fort Apache. Reaching out to the church was another important factor, as that institution is an important one for the people in our community. And here, Father Connolly is speaking, and this is a statement that the Roman Catholic Church in the South Bronx, covering 12 churches, put out condemning the film. The filmmakers utilized a variety of tactics to intimidate the community. Aside from the fact that they had 200 police at their disposal, the man holding the dog is part of the security crew from the film. This is another politician from the South Bronx, Helena Valentin, speaking at one of the rallies. The hospital workers at Lincoln Hospital filmmakers wanted to film in Lincoln, and the hospital workers opposed allowing them to film there and helped add to the numbers in the demonstration. Besides the demonstrations which you see here, there were a number of confrontations at the film sites themselves, a little more difficult to film, however, since the police were snatching people's cameras as the demonstrations were going on. Here's Reverend Daughtry from the Black United Front also speaking. One of the things that was very positive about the movement was the opportunity to build further unity between the Black and Puerto Rican communities. The Puerto Rican Educators Association put out 5,000 copies of their newspaper and gave them to us to distribute free, with the main story being about Fort Apache and the stereotypes, and used them to reach out into the parents' associations in the South Bronx. As the movement grew, it attracted multinational support of not only Puerto Ricans and Blacks, but also Asians and whites, and we think also added to the impact of our protests. As time went on, we also began to see that these large corporations not only have their money and power, but they have a bag of dirty tricks that they can draw on. In one situation, high school students were hired to conduct a pro-Fort Apache demonstration at the same time we were conducting an anti-Fort Apache demonstration. And what you're seeing now facing you are high school students who were hired by the young guy in the tie who worked out of a drug rehabilitation program. here we're talking to students, reading the script to them and letting them know that the film is an attack on them, their families, their future, and their communities. Eventually, the students joined our demonstration. They had been promised $15 an hour for 3 hours' work plus $5 for lunch, which was $50, which in a community of poor people with unemployment of about 60% for young males, that's a lot of money. These two young women were brought down by their mother to the first demonstration that we had. She had heard about it on the radio and brought her children in order to make a statement about their own future. The publicity that the protests were getting, many people said, would bring more people in to see the movie. And we had considered that boomerang effect when we decided to begin the protest. But our position was that rather than concede the arena to the filmmakers, we would challenge them in each area, including in the media, with the hope that even for those people who went in to see the movie, that our protest would set the context within which they would make their analysis. In addition to Puerto Ricans, Dominicans, and other Latin Americans participated in the protests, again, broadening out the base of support with the understanding that anti-Puerto Rican prejudices are applied to all Latins in the United States. This was an effigy that we carried of Paul Newman, and it says, Paul Newman from liberal to racist for $3 million. Our position was that movie stars should be held accountable for their actions like everyone else in society. The press continued to cover the film, and eventually the filmmakers stopped trying to answer us. What they wanted to do was to end the filming, get out of the South Bronx, and get into the editing room as soon as possible. The Spanish language newspaper was crucial in reaching out to our community, which is a Spanish-speaking community. Here at Diario, the largest circulation Spanish language paper in the country, took a position against the film and gave us a number of pages of good coverage. We decided that wherever Newman or any of the filmmakers appeared, we would confront them. And at the Waldorf Astoria, Newman was receiving an award from the Actors Studio, and we confronted him there, and he decided not to come. We thought that was good. Again, we think that people should be held responsible and that there is a price to pay for racism and sexism. This was the leaflet that we gave out to people entering the theaters, urging them not to buy Hollywood racism and not to go inside. Many people left the lines, and many people came over to us afterwards and said, you know, you were right, that movie was racist. We also put out leaflets in Spanish in our own community in advance, letting people know that there would be protests at the theaters when the movie was shown. A nationwide boycott was built, and actions were held in other cities besides New York. They included Philadelphia, Albuquerque, Miami, Florida, Connecticut, New Jersey, and on opening night in Hollywood, a Chicano student organization conducted a militant picket in front of the theater. This sign says in English, "Time and life, our dignity is not for sale," and was one of the slogans that we raised continuously. This was our logo that was designed for us by some artists from the Taller Boricua, the Puerto Rican workshop, which we put on t-shirts and we put on all of our literature, and came to symbolize the resistance and the militancy of our community. The struggle against the movie Fort Apache isn't over, and now in 1982, the messages of Fort Apache, of Black and Puerto Rican inferiority, are even more dangerous as America winds up for war in Latin America, invasion of Granada, prepares for an invasion of Nicaragua, the anti-black and anti-Latin stereotypes are very easily feed into war hysteria for invasion and intervention abroad. In that context, we're raising that the dangers are even more serious than they were in 1980, and the messages of the movie need to be combated even more. We're asking people not only to go out to Washington on November 12th to protest American intervention in Latin America and to get American troops out of Granada and Lebanon, but we're also asking people to join us the next day, Sunday, November 13th, in front of the NBC building on 50th Street and 6th Avenue, where we'll be holding a protest to protest NBC's decision to air Fort Apache on November 27th nationwide. We're asking people to come out to join with us in, number one, a protest against NBC's peddling of racist filth, and number two, in a celebration of the beauty and strength of people who fight for their freedom.
It's a miserable town. It's a nowhere town. And I am leaving this town. You better believe that I'm leaving this town. Man, it will never be uptown. It's bound to be uptown.